Hello and good morning everyone out there in webinar land. It's lovely for you to join us here today for our fifth webinar as part of our Insight APSAT webinar series. My name's Jeff, I'm the director here at Insight and we've got a great guest with us today. But before I move on, I'd like to take this time to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands of which we're gathered here in Meanjin in Brisbane, and also on the lands all across Queensland or Australia, wherever everyone is joining from, and pay respects to elders past, present and emerging. As we extend that respect to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander person joining us here today. Also, I'd like to recognise people who have lived experience of alcohol and drug, mental health and suicide as the reason why lots of us are in this work. And it also gives us the reason to invite our latest guest to join us today. And I'm very pleased to have Associate Professor Lauren Brenner join us today. Lauren is part of the Centre for Social Research and Health at UNSW, and her focus is on stigma and discrimination in relation to marginalised and vulnerable groups. And today, Lauren is going to be talking to us about that particular population's LGBTQIA plus populations. So without further ado, I'd like to throw you over to Associate Professor Lauren Brenner. Welcome, Lauren.
So I also want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands we're meeting on today. I'm talking to you from Bidjigal land in Sydney, and I want to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. So I'm going to be talking to you about an evaluation that we did of ACON Substance Support Service, which is a substance support service targeting the LGBTI community and people who are experiencing issues with drugs or alcohol. So we have a full report. I mean, this presentation might be a little bit cursory because I'm going to try and cover both the quantitative and the qualitative work we did. We have a full evaluation report, which is available on our website. So just to give some background, we know that LGBTI people report disproportionately higher rates of alcohol and other drug use and harms associated with this use. And we know that there's stigma that is aimed towards sexual and gender minorities, and this creates additional barriers to treatment access and uptake, and often can also impact treatment retention. There's limited research on alcohol and other drug treatment outcomes for LGBTI people, especially trans and gender diverse people. And we also know that ACON has a long history of working with the LGBTI community and with community engagement. And at the time that we did this evaluation, which was about a year and a half to 2 years ago, probably longer, I've lost track of time, as we all have with COVID, this substance support service was really quite new. So what we did is we evaluated the substance support service, which is an outpatient counseling service for LGBTI and other sexually and gender diverse people who are affected by, and also those affected by HIV, experiencing problems with AOD use. And we wanted to examine treatment outcomes among clients, whether they experience reductions in substance use at a service that directly targets LGBTI people, whether they have improved psychosocial well-being, and whether the service is actually reaching the different target groups in need of assistance. So just some background on the ACON service, which is obviously not really what I covered, but just to give you some idea of how the service was run. It provides up to 12 individual sessions on identified goals, and clients are able to enter and re-enter treatment as required. The model is a harm reduction model and stages of change approach, with counselors adopting multiple treatment modalities based on the needs of the clients. It operates in a stepped care model, offering brief intervention, tapering of support in preparation for discharge, and the ability to work in parallel with other care coordination services and referral to other care coordination services, develops natural support networks and links with relevant health and community service. It was actually available face-to-face or by phone or online video conferencing, and this was prior to COVID, but ACON has some more regional sites, and so it was able to access clients who are living in regional settings. Provides treatment frequency and intensity of support, which is individualized according to clients' needs, and provides an opportunity for clients to re-enter the service and receive support for lapse and relapse prevention. So the service operates either as a standalone intervention or as a complement to detox, residential rehab, opioid substitution therapy, or aftercare services. There's a centralized intake, fielding inquiries and referrals, or people can also walk in or be referred online. An intake officer aims to follow up in 2 working days, and priority clients are flagged, and clients are contacted by the counselor and offered an appointment within a week. At the start, and this was important for our purposes of our study, at the start, clients undergo a comprehensive biopsychosocial assessment, including the New South Wales minimum data set for drug and alcohol treatment services and NADA's client outcomes management system. And these are administered every 4 counseling sessions to monitor progress and inform treatment goals and strategies, with counselors providing feedback to clients. So our evaluation of this service, which was funded by New South Wales Health, was a mixed methods design. We did a quantitative analysis of treatment outcomes and then in-depth interviews with clients, staff, and stakeholders. And this occurred over about 1.5 years period. There was also a cost analysis of ACON services, which was undertaken by people at ACON with assistance. So I won't really report on the cost analysis, just to say that obviously more money is required to keep the service running at maximum capacity and to actually increase the service capacity. So the quantitative phase consisted of a retrospective analysis of client records between January 2016 and December 2018. So this was a while ago. Again, as I said, we all have lost about 2 years because of COVID. There was cross-service comparisons, or attempts were made to have cross-service comparisons between ACON clients and non-government sites. And these NGO sites were chosen based on similar treatment modalities to ACON. And this didn't work out as well as we hoped. And the reasons, I'll explain the reasons for this as we move through the presentation. So we used this data that was routinely collected from clients attending the NGO services in New South Wales that was collated by NADA as part of the NADA-based system. The primary outcomes for the quantitative data were changes in baseline in days of principal drug of concern in the previous 4 weeks and the severity of dependence scale scores. And the secondary outcomes were changes from baselines in psychological distress scores and quality of life. And our qualitative phase consisted of interviews, which were run between September and May of the following year, where we actually interviewed both current and former clients and LGBTI clients attending mainstream AOD counseling services. And the reason we did that, because that was quite difficult to find clients who were attending mainstream AOD services, but we did that because the comparison of the quantitative data didn't work out as planned. So we wanted to get the perspective of LGBTI clients attending mainstream services another way. These clients were actually recruited via ACON social media and newsletters. So it was people who became familiar with ACON over time, even if they weren't familiar when they did their AOD treatment. And then we also aimed to recruit LGBTI people who had current or prior experience of AOD counselling at mainstream services. Sorry, I think I already said that point. And we recruited ACON staff and key stakeholders, 18 of them. And we used in vivo and thematic analysis approach to analyze this data. The project had a number of challenges, and that was largely related to issues around staffing. And it took us longer to actually complete the project. And there were a number of delays and then revisions to the study when we realized we couldn't compare mainstream clients to NADA clients with the quantitative data. So in terms of the quantitative results, the mean age of ACON clients was 38 years, Abstinence increased from 14% at treatment entry to 28% at the fourth session and 39% at the 12th session. The median number of days that the principal drug of concern was used in the previous 4 weeks reduced from 8 days to 4 days to session four and further reduced at session 12. There were reductions in psychological distress and comparisons between ACON and mainstream clients. This was the issue were judged to be difficult and inappropriate. Firstly, gender and sexuality was generally not recorded at mainstream services, which was problematic. And then the clients actually were quite different, those at mainstream services compared to those at ACON services. And they differed in terms of employment, housing, principal drug of concern, recent substance use, and source of referral into treatment. So that's really quite interesting, except obviously we couldn't compare. And it turned out that ACON clients were older, more likely to be born in Australia or Europe, less likely to identify as Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander, more likely to speak English, more likely to be in paid employment, and more likely to be in stable accommodation. So these are just some graphs which shows the trends across the four sessions. And we divided it up by methamphetamine use, alcohol use, and all substances, because the highest number of, or the principal drug of concern for participants was either methamphetamine or alcohol in both the quantitative and qualitative sample. So here you can see the severity of dependence scale and how this improved across the four sessions that we reported on. Similarly, with quality of life, you can see an improvement across the four sessions. It remains more stable from session four to session 12, but there's definitely a decent improvement from baseline to session four. And again, for quality of life, for anxiety and depression, there's an improvement across the four, or decrease in scores across the four sessions from baseline to particularly session eight, actually. So that's quite interesting. And the days of use, also a decrease from particularly from baseline, and then it seems to be stable, but there's a decrease across the sessions, and more so I think for methamphetamine than any of the other ones. Okay, so that's the end of the quantitative results. And just on the qualitative results now, there were 34 interviews done. The majority of people interviewed identified as gay. The majority were aged between 40 and 50 years. The majority were white Anglo-Australian, similar to our quantitative sample. And similar to the quantitative sample, methamphetamine and alcohol were the most commonly reported principal drug of concern. So this part of the presentation I find quite interesting because it has the quotes, which is nice to hear people's experiences and how they felt about the services. So the service experiences as reported by ACON clients, well, they felt very supported going to a service like ACON, which specifically targeted the LGBTI community. They felt that these counseling sessions provided them with life skills, so more broadly than just coping with their alcohol and drug use, but also helped them to develop further skills to carry them forward moving post treatment. And they particularly valued a queer friendly service. So as Dawn said, my counselor gives me a lot of resources, like would give me podcasts and things, and links to things. So it's an ongoing thing to be supported between sessions rather than go in and then go out. I really like the reception staff and the fact that it's a queer friendly office. Like I don't feel awkward being in the, like waiting for my therapy appointment. Like with the stigma of mental health and addictions, I tell my friends to come here. The counselors have good knowledge about LGBT issues. It's good. So ACON clients spoke a lot about feeling comfortable at the service and that the reception even from the point that you walk in, is a setting that's very comfortable for members of the LGBTI community. And that is really important to make sure that it attracts people into these services, and that they feel comfortable at the opening point or access point, because we know that often clients experience stigma at the front end of a service. So that was really important. For mainstream clients, they were not as motivated to access tailored LGBTI services. They placed more emphasis on the degree of support they needed, and sometimes on low-cost psychological services, but they did express some disappointment around responses to sexual identity. So as Jara said, initially, when I had a work cover psychologist, he was extremely dismissive in relation to like my identity and stuff like that, just treated me horribly. He was a 90-year-old man. It was just really bizarre. But then I only saw this guy a few times. Then when I went to a guy who was bulk billing me, I was really appreciative of the service he was giving me, but they were both like old men that had pretty much no idea, had their lives and their general life and haven't looked outside the box. So I definitely would never refer any of my friends onto them, even though he bulk billed me, because he was such a blessing. At the same time, he was such a burden because I was in a fragile place. He was a burden to my mental health. So that's interesting in the sense that obviously people want to have their sexual identity valued and not have responses that are negative to this, and to have counselors that are able to understand the experiences of people from minority communities. So people did express a preference for a gay counselor and say they would rather pay than be randomly assigned to a mainstream service. As Antonio said, I prefer to see a gay one. Through work, you could see a free one, but that's luck of the draw. So I had to pay for mine privately, which is annoying, but I guess it's a good investment. I Googled it, Gay Counselor Sydney, and then two or three popped up. But it's hard to, you know, shop around, because when you shop around, you have to give them a go, like one or two sessions. Tell them about the problems again from scratch. But then do you see a gay counselor from your background or your age group? At what point do you know, draw the line? Antonio also said, which is interesting, that had he been aware of the free service offered at ACON, he would have accessed support there. And this is the point that I'll come back to, because one of the issues with the ACON Substance Support Service is that it's not as well known as ACON's other services. And so one of the things that came out of this evaluation is a recommendation around greater marketing of the service. So participants' broad experiences of being LGBTI and the effects of health seeking. Participants were concerned about potential discrimination related to their gender or sexual identity, which obviously they wouldn't experience at ACON. And they felt they would only be, these participants felt they would only be welcomed at a service like ACON. Although those who chose mainstream services, where they were a little bit different, is they did not feel the need to seek out LGBTI services because they felt that there were enough changed societal attitudes that they felt comfortable with mainstream services. And this seemed to be more in kind of the metro areas of Sydney and not those in regional settings. So some mainstream clients felt that LGBTI specific services were better able to address the needs of LGBTI people. And they particularly, this is interesting, they particularly spoke about the need for an LGBTI-specific residential rehab service. They felt that public resi rehab services were unsuitable for gay men. As Brian said, I always thought that they needed a rehab just for gay men. A lot of these private rehabs are good, but you know, they're a bit more relaxed, a bit more comfortable, but the public rehabs can be a bit harsh. And I think what happens is that they can be quite intimidating to a lot of gay men. Like I went to one and it's full on, it's hardcore, you know. You're trying to come down to do all this stuff and they're pretty intense. If someone could have come up with a gay rehab, I think they could make a lot of money. So there was an interplay for clients that we found between LGBTI experiences and service choices. So those people who had been discriminated against or had particular issues around their LGBTI identity tended to want to go to a service that was more understanding and was kind of more credible to the LGBTI community. Clients' perceptions of common, that services like ACON would understand the common histories and understandings between that people had between themselves and their counsellor. And those people who needed the solidarity of a shared understanding were then more likely to seek out LGBTI-specific services. As Shania said, having an LGBTQ counsellor is very important. It takes a lot of courage being where I am and where I live. I'm experiencing a hell of a lot of conflict from my Christian neighbors to the point where I can't park my vehicle on or around the property anymore. So you can see that people from these communities are still discriminated against and feel stigmatized. And so for many, it would be much, it was a level of comfort seeking a service that could clearly identify with LGBTI issues. So improving LGBTI AID services for LGBTI people, ACON clients generally had a very positive appraisal of the ACON service. They felt that the service needed to maintain the level and quality of current services and perhaps increase the limit on the number of sessions. And this is where the cost analysis was quite important because they obviously need more funding to be able to, to be able to increase the number of sessions. There was some concern about confidentiality and anonymity at ACON, which was seen to be a problem for some people because ACON is known to be a service that targets people living with HIV or people wanting testing and treatment for HIV. And so people felt that they might be outed as someone living with HIV by attending ACON. But on the whole, they felt that the services need to be ramped up and that a broader range of services could be provided in drug and alcohol treatment through ACON. So the professional stakeholder interviews, there were 18, we did 18 of these between August and May of the following year. These were counselors or other staff of ACON Substance Support Service, staff in other ACON services who referred into the ACON Substance Support Service. 12 external stakeholders, which were really interesting to get their perspective. They worked in a wide range of roles, some at the local health district or at other treatment facilities. Their ages ran from 25 to 61, and the majority had been in their current role for more than 5 years. So their perceptions of ACON service, substance support service, it was not known as well as it should. It was not as highly known as some among some of the external professionals as it could be or should be. ACON itself was very well known and respected within the LGBTI community. Many had attended ACON's capacity building workshops or training events, but knowledge about the actual AOD program, the substance support program, was minimal. So again, as I mentioned, one of the things we spoke about or made a recommendation out of this report is for marketing around the service to be increased. So one of the other things is that the service couldn't always reach the target groups that would be necessary to reach the more marginalized people. And so by marketing it more to clients and to other stakeholders, this would hopefully extend the reach of the service. So staff and stakeholders felt that the holistic approach at ACON was highly valued, that ACON offered a range of services for LGBTI people, so you could come in for counselling services and also access a whole range of other support services there. And that the staff at ACON were more aware of minority stress, historical trauma, and the risk of misgendering clients. So as Marion, an ACON staff member, said, trauma, and I mean, we are lucky in as much as our particular service has a care coordination team. So the social, financial, and legal aspects that come up for people can be managed. We have a lot of internal support, and that's fortunate, because the service that we have in here, it's working across managing all of these things and how they impact on someone's substance use. So that was seen as very highly valued by ACON staff. All the ACON staff and stakeholders did see a role for mainstream AOD services in working with LGBTI clients, because ACON couldn't cover all the needs of all LGBTI clients, but that staff at mainstream services needed adequate inclusivity training. As Bob said, we cannot service the whole LGB community in New South Wales. We cannot do it. We don't have enough. We need mainstream services to jump on board. But I think the only time we should allow them to jump on board is if they've had prior diversity training, which is the training offered by ACON. So knowledge, awareness, and training were seen by stakeholders as a requirement for staff who work with LGBTI people, and that there's a need to do more to attract and engage LGBTI clients by promoting services as LGBTI inclusive. And one of the ways is to make it more comfortable at that reception level, even when people come in or phone into a service or on the website of the service, to ensure that there are symbols that make it inclusive to LGBTI people. And also another way to do this is to highlight the training that staff have undertaken to ensure that they are, that clients feel that staff are able to work with LGBTI people. So as Jason from another LGBTI health service said, I don't know, like I'm not sure if mainstream services are, but I also don't know that they may have well been, have dealt with a lot of LGBT, in which case they might actually already have strategies and policies. This is me guessing, yeah. But in a way, guessing is because if I'm thinking that, then it means they're not marketing the fact that they are inclusive or are diversified. In which case, I have a perception, which whether it's true or not, nothing has changed. They've done nothing to change that perception. So staff had good feedback from clients who'd been referred to ACON Substance Support Service. So that's very good. It was perceived to be well known amongst LGBTI communities. And the LGBTI communities, well, ACON is well known, and they trust the various services and programs that ACON have on offer. So as Bobby said, they have a really robust and effective community engagement strategy for marketing all of their programs. So that awareness and understanding within the local LGBTI community should be there. And I think the benefit is the ACON name. People know it and trust it. So obviously a service that is credible is always highly valued by participants and clients, and extending services of that highly trusted service is always going to be valuable and attract members of that minority group in. Ways that the service could be improved, as I mentioned, better and enhanced promotion of the services just wasn't well known enough. So there was seen to be a need for better interagency communication. And this does happen, that services are established, but the funding isn't there for marketing often. And so it's just not that well known. And so unfortunately, these very good services, clients are not referred to them as frequently as they should be. There was some concern about the intake procedures. These didn't always occur within the timeframes that was stipulated, the 2 days and the 1 week. And that was largely around staffing and again, funding, and directly spoken to in the cost analysis section of this report that we did. So, and again, there's so much, and I'm sure all of you have the same experiences around more funding being required and longer term funding cycles. So in conclusion, the quantitative analysis showed significant improvements in severity of dependence, quality of life, K10, and days of use across the four measurement times and 12 sessions. So what this shows us, firstly, is the importance of having a LGBTI specific service. Unfortunately, we couldn't compare it to mainstream service. So a mainstream service may also be effective. It's just that they attract different client groups, but it showed for this evaluation that an analysis of client records is very useful for an evaluation for those who's sitting with lots of data collected at various points in clients' treatment journey. It can be used to look at these assessments. As I noted, a comparison with mainstream clients was just not possible. And it's highly recommended, and you know, we've had various discussions with NADA about this, that collecting gender, and NADA have spoken to their groups as well, that collecting gender and sexuality at all AOG services is recommended, and that staff are trained in how to collect this, this information, because there seems to be a perception around that there's sensitivity in collecting this really standard data, I guess. Clients who have accessed ACON substance support services were very satisfied, and they were motivated to access a tailored service as they felt it was more likely to meet their needs. So obviously tailored for LGBTI clients. Their clients' perspectives, though, on mainstream services were also generally satisfactory, but they did feel that they needed more visible signifiers of being LGBTI inclusive, so people felt comfortable at point of entry, and that staff should be, have more training, and that this this prior diversity training should be emphasized if they've had the training. And also that ACON gives that training. So that could be a one way to reduce the burden on ACON for specific services. If they don't have enough, if they can't take in more clients, then they can train up other staff at mainstream services to be comfortable to work with LGBTI clients. So health professionals agreed that the availability of tailored AOD services was very beneficial for LGBTI people, especially things around feeling comfortable to talk about sexual identity and to talk about issues related to perhaps trauma or anything specific for LGBTI communities, including stigma and discrimination, of course. They saw that there was still a value in providing these mainstream AOD services, because we need to have a range of services for clients, but we need to have a range of services where clients feel comfortable to attend. So these services need to be equipped to provide culturally appropriate care. LGBTI specific services play an important role in understanding and responding to the health needs of this community and in reducing barriers to accessing other services. So what was important here with access to other services is that these LGBTI specific service would refer clients to continuing care services where they would feel comfortable. And that's really important. And clients, I guess, felt comfortable attending services that they were recommended to attend by ACON. So that's it. Just an acknowledgement to our funders. To the people from ACON who were involved in the research, to the people from NADA who were involved in the research, our stats advice, and to our project advisory group. So thank you everyone for listening to the talk. And this is just a slide for the next talk that will be given to you on the 11th of May. So thank you, Lauren,
we're very good. If you're okay, we'll just ask a couple of questions that have come up through the chat throughout the course of the presentation. So we've got a couple of questions. And first of all, congratulations on that study and some of the outcomes that you achieved. Obviously, some of that in-depth qualitative work reveals some really great data that we often don't get through the quantitative. That's really good. So some of the questions, one was, is there any further information on the details of the 12 sessions with clients, including the therapeutic approach or model used? We might have covered some of that, but there's another question, I guess, which is, do you guys develop or use a specific tool or structure for LGBTI plus people? So is there a difference in the actual modality or the treatment approach for this client group, or is it the same as what would typically be offered in a mainstream service, just the service setting is different? Is it tweaked for the audience?
So I guess, unfortunately, I'm not the right person to answer that because we, you know, I worked on the evaluation and my training is research, not the counselling aspect of it. But there is more detail in the report that was written up. ACON included more about the treatment modality in the report. And I think the best thing would be for me to get in contact, if you want more information on that, to put you in contact, or whoever's asked the question, with the relevant people at ACON who'd be able to answer that in more detail.
All right. And is that report available, do you know? Or?
Yes. So our report's available on our website, which was in the first slide. So these slides will be made available to everyone, and you can access the report off our website. But again, the detail around the modality of counselling is not that substantial because the focus of the report was on the evaluation. So if anyone wants more detail, ACON really is the place to go to. And I can put anyone in contact with the key person at ACON to speak to about that.
Thanks. There's another question which is around how, I guess, mainstream services can promote or ensure that they're LGBTI safe and friendly and appropriate, including some practical things around maybe features of the reception waiting area that might make people feel comfortable. Do you have any like that or other kind of indicators, signifiers of safety and appropriate access for LGBTI clients?
So I think, you know, the thing is that idea around the thing around making a service comfortable and having a reception that's comfortable and also symbols and signifiers on a website that suggests that or indicates that people have had at the start have had training, say Pride Diversity training offered by ACON or any kind of training that's inclusive is really important. I know in another project I did looking at priority populations in the ACT, people spoke a lot about wanting services to acknowledge their community group, you know, either in pamphlets or posters in reception or on their website. So I think that makes people feel comfortable to engage with a service at the first point. And I think the training of staff is really important because once staff are trained, there's a greater awareness of how to work with LGBTI groups. I think sometimes, you know, and again, I don't work in these services, but having worked with a range of different marginalized communities in a research capacity, I think sometimes, like, I don't feel that comfortable. So if people share with me how best to interact with that community, it makes me a whole lot more comfortable. Or if I'm trained up in a way of how to deal best with that community. So that training, I think, is really important because it allows the worker to feel comfortable, even in terms of how to ask those questions around sexuality. I think that people don't ask it sometimes because they don't feel comfortable. So if we're just trained on how to do it best, then we'll feel comfortable and clients will feel comfortable as well. So I'm not sure that that answers the question, but I think it's just really about training.
No, I think that does. Thanks, Lauren. You probably may not be able to answer this question, but they want to know if there's a directory of LGBTI plus friendly services. We know the Rainbow Tick accreditation process that services can do to self-assess whether or not they meet kind of those minimum standards or standards for being LGBTI friendly. Do you know if there's a directory or is it?
Again, I don't know those things. It might be worthwhile, you know. What might be interesting for one of these presentations is to get ACON to speak, you know, because they may also be able to update a bit on the service. It's been a couple of years and they would be able to answer those questions. And I mean, as you know, ACON has a lot of expertise in this area.